हेलो हेमंत,
हेलो,
या हेमंत, यू कैन हियर मी राइट?
यस आई कैन हियर यू।
ओके, वीडियो इज रिक्वायर्ड। जनरली आई स्विच ऑफ द कैमरा सो दैट द बैंड विड्थ इज नॉट गेट लॉस्ट।
या इट्स ऑल राइट, वीडियो इज नॉट रिक्वायर्ड।
ओके ओके ठीक है।
ओके
बिकॉज इन हियर अपार्टमेंट द इंटरनेट कनेक्टिविटी इज इशू, सो इफ यू पुट ऑन द कैमरा अगेन इट विल फर्दर स्लो डाउन।
ओके ओके नो प्रॉब्लम।
ओके फाइन, सो लेट मी नो व्हेन आई हैव टू अनम्यूट, आई विल जस्ट स्टार्ट द
Yes,
प्रेजेंटेशन।
I will start the session and
ओके
then give a brief introduction, then you can start.
ओके सो हियर हाउ टू शेयर द स्क्रीन। ऑलरेडी आई पैनलिस्ट, आई कैन शेयर नाउ इटसेल्फ?
When I meet you, I will talk.
नो, कैन आई शेयर नाउ इटसेल्फ? नो, यू हैव टू
I
गिव।
will make you panelist and then you can start sharing.
हाँ, ऑलरेडी यू हैव मेक मी पैनलिस्ट।
No, I will make you presenter.
अच्छा, दैट टाइम ओनली कैन शेयर। ओके 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 सो
Yes.
एज ऑफ नाउ यू आर द प्रेजेंटर, योर स्क्रीन इज कमिंग राइट?
यस
ओके ओके ठीक है। ओके
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the 19th session of GreenPro webinar series. My name is Hemant. I'm part of GreenPro team, Institute of Hyderabad. We are part of the Confederation of Indian Industry, CII. Today we have the topic of waste to wealth for sustainable environment. As you might be aware that these days waste to wealth has become an important concept in our daily activities from both industrial as well as from normal social perspective as well. Increasing waste results in different resources that are available, with most of it going to landfills. So in this webinar, we are trying to just introduce the concept of waste to wealth, give a perspective on it, and show a few demonstrations of how this can be implemented practically, the waste to wealth concept. So today with us, we have three speakers, Mr. Sabyasachi Sen Gupta, Senior Counselor from CII, Ms. Manisha Narke, Founder and CEO from Ajwar Green Life, and Mr. Balaji Saravanan, Assistant General Manager Quality from Visakha Industries Limited. So these speakers will be taking us through this concept of waste to wealth and its application. So now I would request Mr. Sabyasachi to take over and present.
Thank you, Hemant. Hemant?
Yes, you are audible, Sabyasachi. And I have made the presenter.
Okay. So good afternoon to all of you. So hope everyone is doing well in the current lockdown situation, which is of course affecting to all of us. So hope my screen is visible.
Yes, sir. Screen is visible.
Okay. So first of all, I wish all the very best to all of you, to your family members who are all trying very hard in this current difficult situation. So we strongly believe we all together will overcome the situation very soon. So the topic, whatever our department is choosing today, it is very apt for this current industry content, because waste is no more is considered waste. I think all of us know that. So it is generally called as the resources. And when the resource is concerned, it like any other resource, every company want to try to conserve the resource as much as possible. The same way how we conserve our raw material, our fuel, in fact, our money also. So for next 25 to 30 minutes, I will just quickly go through some of the experience, what we have worked with the industry and what we have observed, how the industries are considering the resource optimization through their various efforts. So currently the people who are, So if you see, most of us, whoever is participated for today's session, either you are representing any manufacturing companies like engineering, automobile, glass, ceramics, tires, or it can be any service organized. It can be hotels, it can be airports, it can be hospitality sector. So what is our main focus for any industry, be it manufacturing, be it service organization? So our main focus is how I can increase the profit of the my business, correct? Because end of the day, that matters, money matters. So whatever the activity we are doing, ultimately end of the day, I should be in a profitable position, be it in the resource, be it in the financial term, everywhere. So if I take the profit definition, we all know it is whatever the sales or service amount minus the operating cost, it is coming as a profit. So if I want to increase the profit, so ideally I should either increase the sales or service part, or I should try to reduce my operating cost. This is the very basic principle where most of the companies always try to make an effort of it. But if you see, there are various factors are in, considered between sales and the reducing operating cost. Whatever the sales is concerned, the results are quite unpredictable. Although I may have a very strong marketing team, I have a very strong strategical team to focus on the next 6 months or 1 year business. How the market demand is going to be the position. Accordingly, I can plan my production and schedule. Everything we are doing, all of us having a strong team, production team, planning team, purchasing team, marketing team, everyone is doing. But still, many times the results are unpredictable because we don't know what the market is going to behave next 6 months or 1 year period. And for example, this COVID situation, we are not sure, like from 22nd March onwards, the entire country, leave the country, entire world will be in a grinding situation which no one has forecasted. And all our prediction has gone for a toss. That is one very challenging thing what we are looking into. And of course, it is depending upon many external factors. For leave COVID, there are many other external factors that there. Cost is there, a new competitor into the market is there. So it is highly unpredictable to increase the sales part. On the other way, for the operating cost, whatever is concerned, many things are quite predictable because we know what is my operating cost in day-to-day operation to run my factory, to run my business. Okay, and it is mostly internal factors. Of course, there are some external factors are there, but if I try to minimize my operating cost, one way or other, I can increase my profitability. So that is the purpose for me to showing these slides here. So if you see for any particular industry, Hemant, please let me know if sometime if I'm not audible, okay? Because there is some bandwidth issue always comes. Okay, sorry for the interruption.
Yeah.
So for any industry, for any operation, so now if you, I think all of us are following all the leading news channels, or CNN, IBN, or India Today. So everywhere industry leader, our CI director general, or our top industry leader, everyone is talking about how the companies can control the fixed cost. Okay, the variable costs are anyway there, that is linked with the production and many other things. But whatever the fixed costs are concerned, that day Mr. Rahul Bajaj was giving a very nice interview in the NDTV in the night 10 to 10:30 PM. I think many of us have seen that. So he was giving very detailed analogy how the company is very very aggressive looking to optimize the fixed cost without hampering the job, without hampering the employee salary. So by and large, typically the fixed cost for any industry, it is in terms of the raw material, in terms of the manpower cost, in terms of the energy cost, transportation cost, and also there is a cost which is linked to the waste management and the pollution control. So first four costs, it can be some costs are the fixed, some costs are the variable, some costs are the fixed and variable both together. But waste management and the pollution control, it is some of the activity which most of the industry take care of as a last priority. So they know yearly they have to spend some 50 lakhs or 1 crores of rupees for treatment or disposal of this waste management activity to comply with the regulatory requirement. That is the way so far conventionally most of the companies are looking into it. Yeah, I have to spend some so much lakhs or crores of rupees annually to give it to the TSJ facility and my responsibility is over just to meet the compliance. But now, or not only for this current difficult situation, last almost 1 or 2 years or 3 years, the scenario is getting changed. So people are not taking meeting the regulation as a compliance kind of thing. So they are looking it as an opportunity to further improve their operating performance and further bringing down of the cost of the waste management pollution control. So my subsequent slide, I will explain you some various trends what we have observed recently working with the industry, how every company is now looking to reduce their operating cost for the waste management pollution control through various approaches. So you can call it, it's a resource management trends what we are currently following in Indian industry. So now the people mindset is changing, so they are looking into a different approach. This is what I am just trying to share with you. So the first trend what we have seen into the companies by working with them, our team, we are working with the industry, even Hemant and Hemant teams also work with the industry in various sectors. So slowly there is a complete change in the mindset of the senior management for any company. So they are not taking waste management activity as an additional activity. Instead of that, they are taking waste management activity as part of their corporate strategy. So whenever the strategy formulation is happening, waste management, pollution control, or people are talking as a resource conservation, resource efficiency, circular economy, I think you are all aware about these terms. So these terms are no more a buzzword. This is the part of the regular business strategy. So the companies are looking how the waste management activity can be part of the corporate strategy so that their entire business strategy can be linked with this waste management activity. Just for a quick example, I just show some two leading companies for their corporate policy. This is the Jacquetar Industries policy, and this is the Tata Steel sustainability policy. I am not going to the detail of each and every aspect what they have mentioned into their policy, but only two things I just want to highlight. So both the cases, the company have a specific target taken to reduce their waste to going to the landfill, at the same time saving the natural resource and improving their ecological footprint. So like earlier, company used to take the target to reduce the specific energy consumption, specific water consumption, yield improvement, packaging material reduction. But now, apart from that, companies are also taking very focused target how they can reduce the cost or to reduce the waste amount that is going to the landfill to some certain percentage. So in that aspect, to meet those kind of target, the companies are taking very diligent approach to categorize the type of waste whatever has been generated from their facility and to have very specific focused action plan so that each and every type of waste have a proper scientific way of management and the handling or the treatment. And disposal, they always take it as a last priority so that they always try to optimize the reuse recycling and the reduce concept within the factory or maybe tied up with some authorized recycler, so that they have a very controlled approach to minimize the landfill activity. So another example, this is a very typical flowchart for a waste management activity in a foundry, which is an engineering industry. So typically, any foundry, the this natural sand or the chemically bonded sand, it is one of the major type of the waste, which is almost 60 to 70% of the entire hazardous waste that is generated from a foundry industry. So earlier days, the industry used to dispose it into the landfilling activity, or they just want to get rid of this kind of services. But recently, while working with one of the leading foundry, the Brakes India is one of the leading supplier to all the leading automobile companies. So we have seen that they are treating or handling this sand as good the way they treat their natural or the raw material. So their proper inventory has been maintained, database has been maintained. So they are tied up with the authorized recycler who is handling the this kind of sand in a very scientific way. Even there is another foundry that is called the LMW foundry. Many of you might be heard about it. They are based in Coimbatore. So they have a reclamation plant which is reclaiming more than 95% of the chemically bonded sand. And again, they are reusing that sand for the foundry operation. So ultimately, they are reducing their dependence on the virgin material. So that is the way people are taking key, whatever waste is generated, how I can make it more usable by having the more reuse, recycle, and the reclamation activity. Okay. And whenever nothing is workable, then only I should look for the disposal, but that is also very properly to the authorized recycler. Another very interesting case study, what we have seen many SME companies, how their journey from gray to green is happening. So the first picture, this is a very typical picture of any scrap yard. If you go to any engineering industry, any automobile factory, or any like ancillary units of automobile, you can see all kind of waste is getting dumped to a common place. And every monthly or weekly or 15 days in a month, one vendor comes. So they pack entire waste in a truck and they take it and they pay on a lump sum basis. This is the most of the companies follow this typical type of approach. But their company does not know how much money he is losing by disposing to a single vendor on a lump sum contract. So when we are working for one of the leading SME of the Godrej & Boyce, so they also started facing the same problem. So they know they are also losing a lot of valuable materials. But now what they have done, they have started compartmentalizing of each and every category type of waste. And finally, after 6 months of rigorous experiment, so now if you go to that place, so they are not considering them as a waste yard. They are considering as a, they don't consider scrap yard, they consider as a waste management and the control area. So it is as good as any department. So this is the Amber Enterprise, this is Nanjangaon district. And the beauty of the thing is, after having this proper segregation and disposal method, identify segregation and disposal method, they have reduced their cost of disposal almost by 30 to 40%. Because earlier, many of the valuable materials, metal substance, which by unknowingly they are sending it to the scrap dealer, and ultimately it is disposed as a regular cost of the hazardous waste. Now their hazardous waste quantity has been properly identified. It is stored separately, and only those hazardous waste, whatever the amount, some 100 liters, 200 liters, that waste oil kind of stuff, or the this ETP sludge and this grinding mark or any cotton waste, that part only getting disposed to the waste, hazardous waste vendors. Remaining all things, either they are having an in-house recycling facility or they are sending it to the external recycling facility, so that they are getting paid for it. So that is the way they are significantly reduce their cost of disposal, and that is one of the very excellent example what we have seen even for SME companies. The second trend what we are going to share is the interesting trend that is happening almost last 8 to 10 years period, Till the time, Indian cement industry is working with AI very aggressively, and now it is a very common trend. So people are not considering waste as a disposable material. So they are considering it either as a raw material or as an alternate fuel, which can be either used internally in my facility, or I can find out some buyer where I can send this kind of alternate fuel or the raw material for their purpose. So that the disposal activity is completely gone out of the picture. Okay, that is a very there's a very common trend which is happening across the industry. So one industry's waste is considered either raw material or fuel. So it is something like a eco-industrial platform, or you can say that there are many terminologies which we can define for this particular activity. So this is a basically eco-industrial platform where this concept is working upon. So for example, this is this LD slag, which if you someone is from the steel industry, you can this LD slag is typically a huge amount of waste that is typically getting generated during this pig iron to crude steel processing activity. So this is a brief flowchart. I am not going to the details of it because steel industry people, they understand this is the LD slag activity. So conventionally, what was happening, this kind of steel slag was getting disposed to the landfilling work. Okay, and it is a very menace for the company to manage that, including the leading steel factories like Tata Steel or the JSW Steel. Okay, so but now what is happening? This LD slag is having a high, a very unique properties which is can be considered as a good building block manufacturing or the construction activity. So in the left hand side, I just listed down the properties of the this LD slag, like angular in shape, surface. They have a very bulk specific gravity. They have a good abrasion properties, alkaline properties. So, and it can be utilized many of the activities, including the road construction, in the building construction, when cement manufacturing process, you can use this kind of LD slag. And one of the leading steel plants, they have used the LD slag disposal in last 5 years to just almost 40 to 45% by identifying a different way of reusing and recycling this kind of material. And currently, this industry is having more than 59% utilization of this LD slag as a raw material to other industry. This is another good example where a very valuable waste material is using as a raw material to other industry. Similar thing we are seeing for this brick manufacturing process, how the fly ash is getting utilized, this boiler fly ash getting utilized. Of course, many of you know that this fly ash mission, after the fly ash mission, there is a huge demand for the fly ash. Even nowadays, power plant, you don't get fly ash as a free. So almost all power plant are already booked either with the cement plant or the brick manufacturing process. And this uniqueness of this fly ash based building block is, it is a high demand green building material. Of course, my subsequent presenter also will highlight to their waste material how they're using for that. But the fly ash based building block is considered as one of the useful building material. It has many green building properties and activities. Similarly, this many of the cement industry in the country, they are using other industries' waste like chemical sludge or from the or the pharma industries or the ETP sludge or the tire chips. Wherever the calorific value is more than 3,500 kilocalorie more, their idea of utilizing is as an alternate fuel or maybe the low grade limestone. Or the this iron-based material from this, for example, this slag, what is coming out from the steel industry, they are using it as a binding material, as a raw material to the cement manufacturing process, which is significantly helping the cement plant to reduce their dependency upon the virgin material. So currently, Indian cement plants, our thermal substitution rate is much, much less than the global level. But European cement plants are talking to 80 to 85% thermal substitution rate. We are still struggling is less than 10% of thermal substitution rate with the alternate fuel. So our target for the Indian cement plant is how we can achieve 25% thermal substitution rate by 2025. That is a big target. And the good thing is India does not have any dearth of the waste material. We have all type of waste is available, all kind of waste, which is having either good calorific value or fuel properties or raw material properties are available. Only thing is our industry should be aware enough and the waste generator should be aware enough where all kind of waste can be channelized through the raw material, either to cement plant or any other industry for a alternate fuel of the raw material. In fact, CI have a waste exchange platform. Maybe I can share you separately after the presentation. So where we have an online platform like a buyer-seller meet for what industry OS can be utilized other industry as a raw material of the fuel. The third trend what we have observed is like not only by reducing the OS generation, but by changing of the design also, many companies are reducing their virgin material consumption. So for example, this is one typical case study of a Fastener manufacturing company. The company is called Sundaram Fastener, which is a leading Sundaram Group, SFL Group company. So what they have done, so earlier this kind of this Fastener they are manufacturing, but to save the raw material, so they have formed a small recess over the top of the this fastener. So for each product, they are saving almost 1 to 3 grams of raw material per product. Okay. So their annual production is all like a million number of pieces. So you can imagine how much amount of the raw material they are saving by just simply changing the design of the particular component without affecting any product quality. Okay. So that is the one of the beauty of changing of the design. So I think most of you have already gone through this kind of small Kaizen activity in your facility. Similarly, when we are working with the tire industry, so every tire is having a binder. This is kind of packaging material they are using. So earlier they are using the metal strip, which each metal strip is having 25 grams. So for 4 strip is required, so 100 grams was utilizing for one tire. But now people are changing to the this recycle based poly material. So where more than 80% reduction in packaging material is happening by simply changing the substitution of the packaging material. That is how people are also, because ultimately this packaging material is of no use. After the buyer use the tire, they just simply throw this kind of packaging material to the garbage. So that is the way people are also trying to reduce the packaging material consumption. Similarly, asbestos generation, asbestos is one of the hazardous substances in most of the industry. Now people have completely changed from the asbestos based gloves to the composite material or the cotton.
Hello, Sunil Sachin.
About the green packaging. So most of the manufacturing companies, they are now having the packaging material. And nowadays packaging, of course, it is considered 20-30% of my entire raw material profile. But after the end of the day, it is as a waste is considered because the user is not bothered about the packaging content, but they're mainly bothered about the product what I'm buying. So now people are all talking about the green packaging and sustainable packaging. Why the focus is mainly sustainable sourcing of the raw material, what is the recycle content of the packaging material, how much is the biodegradable content, and how the end of the packaging material is getting managed. And they are also looking to the alternate material, like the packaging, but to the waste material as a packaging material, to the corrugated boxes, or the returnable pallets, or styrofoam. And they are also working how they can reduce the design of the packaging material, or reducing the weight of the packaging material to optimize the packaging material content. So some of the cool example, like this is how the packaging material flow has been completely changed over a period of time. Earlier, people used to send to the corrugated boxes. Now they are sending to the returnable trays. Or people are using the trolleys. So they are sending to the completely trolley-less kind of packaging material. So, and this is another very interesting case study like this Volvo, what we have seen that. So they are having this closed-loop packaging handling. So they call it as a make-run system. So they have tied up with a dedicated vendor where all the has been transferred from their supplier side to their other plant, and again the packaging, that crate has been transferred to other manufacturing facility. So through that, there is no packaging material is getting generated. It is only the product which is getting transferred from the one plant to another plant. So it's very common to most of the automobile companies. Even this kind of this periware or any other indoor pipes or our in most of these sanitary ware manufacturing companies, so they are now optimizing the packaging material utilization and through only covering the critical parts of the product. And through that, this Toto is one of the leading the sanitary ware manufacturing. So they have reduced more than 48% of the packaging material by using the design. And this is another interesting case study in the Godrej Industries, where they are tied up with the third parties and the NGOs to the municipality, where end of life material has been completely collected by the companies, and they are managing it to recycle to sustainable way to reduce the packaging material generation. And the final trend, what we have observed here is the innovation. How the companies are applying innovative mind into their process to reduce the waste generation. So So for example, for any engineering industry, this metal chips, this mining and boring scrap management is a very major headache. It's always bulky in nature, and whenever it is getting generated, it is full of oil and other grinding kind of thing. And as per the hazardous waste management rule, it is also is considered a major hazardous waste. So people always find difficulty how to dispose this. So last picture in the my presentation is the typically way how people are disposing this kind of grinding. So now there is a solution which is coming to the market that is called the metal chip compactor, where more than 80% of your entire bulky metal can be compacted to 1:4 ratio, and you can get more than 10 to 100% increase in your chip selling price, because after compaction it will be like a solid metal blocks which is dried off any oil, any substances, and you can sell it easily to your any customer. Okay, so you can completely separate the oil and coolant, and you can get a 95% reduction in fume emission from furnace and other things. So there is a many companies are in this particular aspect. Like Yuken is one of the major supplier. They are based in Bangalore, but we have many companies who are working into this direction. So this is some of the trends I have shared. So coming by before closing my presentation, I just also want to share some of my sites how CII is also working to this resource efficiency activity. So this Greenko journey, whatever I have shared, like all the company has overcome to the Greenko journey. So Greenko is one of the excellent tool which has been developed by CII in 2012. So this is one of the unique tool to improve the operational efficiency of the industries and how they can improve further over a period of time. And it is taking a life cycle approach, and it is purely performance-oriented approach where the companies are evaluated. And it is one of the first of its kind rating program what currently we are working. And because we have consulted across the world many sectors, but nowhere this kind of rating is already available. So currently, this rating is this is the latest version of the Greenko rating, where the companies are getting evaluated under 1,000 points, under 10 environmental parameters, and every parameter has a certain unique requirements which the company has to comply. And through the process, they also improve internal operational efficiency. So currently, more than 650 companies are working in this Greenko journey. And as a summary, we can show how the benefits have been achieved by the Greenko. So more than 300 companies have achieved the Greenko, and a good number of the people have been trained by the Greenko. We have multiple chapters across the country. It is already been considered into the IIM Ahmedabad as part of their curriculum. And currently, a huge saving has been achieved by the Greenko company, which is the most important factor. You can just see the numbers here. I am not going through the details. And overall, more than 12.57 crores of annual companies, which is a reported benefit. It is not the assumptive number. It's a reported benefit the company has achieved through applying approaches in multiple activities, or resource, or water, or material, or life cycle, or any other areas where the company has been achieved the benefits. And Greenko is also working with multiple sector. We have a MOU with the Indian Railways. Currently, we are working with entire country, all the railway workshop production facility. It is already recognized by the UNIDO. They're also recognized by the UNFCCC. This Indian INDC document in Greenko is already recognized by the government. Already, Rajasthan Pollution Control Board and Tamil Nadu Pollution Control Board also working with us. And we have many sector association where Greenko has been getting working with the partnership, like Tiruppur Textile Association or Indian Textile Association, etc. So as a summary, I can say that Greenko is one of the excellent tool which will help you not only optimizing your resource, improving your performance, but also help you in terms of the to achieve your water neutral status, to help you to achieve carbon neutral status, to reduce your toxicity, to improve your packaging, to improve your productivity, to improve your supply chain footprint, and finally to make you world-class green company across all these parameters. So that is my presentation. This is a short brief to explain you how the resource efficiency initiatives is taking by the companies. But we have many more case study we can share with you. You can go to our website, greenbusiness.com, and there you can find out many more interesting case study which you can directly download in the operation. So thank you all to listening to me.
Thank you, Sabyasachi, for the wonderful presentation and sharing with us various different paths that waste to wealth concept or resource efficiency improvement is taking. Now I would like to invite Ms. Monisha. CEO and founder, Aryuar Greenlight, to make the presentation.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Yeah, it is kudos to Mr. Sen Gupta. Really interesting insights. I also learned a lot of new things from the case study. So looking forward to sharing about the work we do. I will just share the slides. Just to confirm, are the slides visible?
Yes, ma'am, the screen is visible. Please make it a presentation.
Yeah.
Okay. I request you to complete within 20 to 20 minutes as we are on time constraint.
Yes, yes, sure.
Okay.
I'll focus on the key aspects. So good afternoon to everybody. Great to see many enthusiastic green champions part of this program. I'm going to focus a lot on a different angle from Mr. Sen Gupta. It's pretty much what you as individuals or people in corporate, residential society, schools can achieve through becoming conscious about your waste. So it's on the front end of how each of us as an individual can play a role. So to start with, I'll share a little background about our organization. That's RUR, RUR Green Life. We are a 10-year-old social environment enterprise. We are working on sustainable and decentralized waste management solutions. Thus, the name RUR stands for RU, Reducing, Reusing, Recycling. The three pillars of waste management, the three R's basically. That's what we sensitize and educate citizens to become eco-conscious about. So just have a look at a little perspective of India, where we are at. As we know, all of us, especially the metros, end up producing a lot of waste. That in spite of a lot of companies even having green certificates and processes in place, do end up with a lot of waste that gets transported, collected by the local municipal corporations. And it's a huge burden on the economy because a lot of taxpayers' money, like in Mumbai, it's almost 300 crores of taxpayers' money that goes into collection, transportation, and dumping of waste into Asia's largest landfill at Deonar, which is a colossal loss of waste. And we've heard about fires and the pollution that happens from it. And there is a perspective with India that, you know, there are a lot of theories that say, oh, we should put waste to energy plants, and we should have a lot of centralized technologies in India to solve this whole waste problem. But India is a typical case of a lot more organic content of waste, where there's a lot of moisture, a low calorific value in our waste streams, which actually makes these biochemical, converting to fuel a tougher challenge. Also, we have a lot of our land issues. We are running out of space, and there's a lot of stuff in terms of waste composition that makes it difficult to recycle. Although we have high recycling numbers, but we are all in an informal sector. So a lot of the waste gets lost, doesn't follow the circular economy pattern of where we can do waste to resource recovery, putting back materials into the supply chain, which is very imperative for us, especially with paper, cardboard, all the recyclable materials. So having said that, we at RUR 10 years ago did a lot of awareness and engagement to get people to be sensitized on segregation at source. And we realized that especially in households, residential complexes, even in offices, a large quantity of our waste is organic, biodegradable waste. And this biodegradable waste can be easily converted into a resource, which can help increase green power. So there are various ways to take care of organic waste. One is, of course, biogas, and the other is composting. And in composting, there are various forms of composting, aerobic and anaerobic. However, the greener we want to get, the more sustainable, would be to map nature, map the environment. So we looked at technologies. We realized there was a gap. There was a lot of myths about composting. People are not easily doing it because they're afraid of smell, afraid of hygiene, bugs, maggots. You know, there are lots of these myths that needed to be busted. And this was because of the lack. A lot of people just dig up a pit and then 4 months of monsoon and they don't know how to manage their biodegradable waste. So we did a lot of research at RUR in Mumbai. And
madam,
hello.
Yes, ma'am. There is a gray patch on the screen. Can you just reshare the application again?
Okay, reshare it.
Yes, the screen is not completely visible. There is a gray patch which is affecting the view.
Okay, I'll just try to.
By resharing the content.
Yes, yes. Is it better now?
No, ma'am. The gray patch is still there.
One minute. I'll just stop. And
yes, ma'am. It is reduced. Okay, now the screen is.
Is it better now?
One second, your screen is not yet visible.
Yeah, yeah.
There's still a bit of gray patch on the top.
Gray patch. You have done full screen share.
Yes, now it is all right.
Oh,
please continue.
Great. Sorry for the inconvenience on that. Great. So, as I was sharing, that We realize the technology gap, and we realize that a lot of our waste is organic, especially in corporate offices. We have canteen in factories. We have, you know, a couple of hundred people eating in the canteen, and that's organic barrier. All your food, tea leaves, meat, fish bones, eggshells, all this is a huge chunk of waste, which if it gets bagged into a bag, and we find in a lot of waste orders that these people who put it out, they bag it, it's wet, it's hard to deal with. And then they dump it into the trucks and they land up in the landfill. So you're basically transporting moisture, almost 80% water, emitting carbon into. And those who have conventional systems, especially the pits, then they are limited, or doing vermicomposting, they're limited in the input waste. So they can't put cooked food, they can't put citrus peel, so they land up putting some vegetables and leaves. But a large chunk of the biodegradable organic matter is not handled. And therefore, we did research, but we wanted to make sure that it's sustainable. We wanted to make sure there's not much energy consumption, that we are ensuring no additives, no chemicals. We get a very high quality compost, which can be utilized in green space cover. So we designed a system called RGGC, that's RUR Green Gold Aerobic Biocomposter. And I'm really happy that we've had a lot of cooperation from IGBC, CII, for the whole rating process. We thought that for waste management to get due recognition and credibility in an organization, the technology must be endorsed, it must be certified. And so we filed for an NDA patent, which is in the process, and we have also the Green Pro rating of the product is a rated product. And we have different models of these. They are at home level. If you see in the picture, there's an excess, which takes care of 1 kg per the household waste. And in these times of especially lockdown and post-COVID, there's a lot of concern of household waste, especially if there's a house with an infected patient. What are you going to do with the waste? So municipalities have to fumigate and insulate the waste to ensure that, you know, they're not having any contaminants. And therefore, these simple technologies of composting can really help the environment in a large way. So home composting, community composting, at household level or within a complex residential complex, in a school, within a corporate office is what we recommend. And we have different models based on the input waste that's been generated at site. So the S, M, L, and C are cascadable. So you can connect them in a group, and they are very portable, lightweight, simple to use. So the uniqueness in the design is we have these air ventilators, which you see on top. They're smart for aeration. They allow the process to be in continuous aerobic state. Therefore, eliminating any smell issue. And we have taken care of using materials and raw materials that make it more durable. So it's long-lasting, low on operation cost, and several features to ensure that the product is sustainable. So I'm going to share a case study with you to give you an idea of how it's applied. There is a residential complex in Mahi, Mumbai, Madhoshi Pearl. You can see the building, it's a towering matchboxy building, which has about 65 families. And they've been running the project now for almost 2.5 years. And they have daily waste generation, which out of which almost 70% is biodegradable kitchen waste is generated. And most buildings like these in Mumbai or in urban cities, Delhi, Bangalore, you have lack of compound space. So what do you do? You need space for waste management. And therefore, we have suggested to them to bring it on the terrace. And most terraces, if you see, are not used, not occupied. So here we put the compostors on the terrace. And waste management, unlike other projects, like if you have a solar panel project that you're doing for your office or housing complex, solar water, solar heating. And nobody really needs to involve the sun.
Miss Manisha, sorry to interrupt. Your voice is breaking a bit. Can you?
Okay, I'll just see. Is this better?
Your voice is breaking a bit. Yes, yes, now it's better.
Yeah. For waste management, we need to make sure that stakeholder participation is there, because unlike other projects, here it is very dependent on people participation. We need to make sure that the waste is segregated at source. So you can have any technology, you can have biogas, composting, any technology you may put in place, but the input waste needs to come segregated, and that is why the participants, and then often for the factory, the employees need to be sensitized. If it's in a residential complex, the members need to be sensitized. So it's important to find a partner who is not just an equipment supplier, but someone who is awareness, education, get the housekeeping motivated to manage. And therefore, we have to be very, because it's very easy for people to throw the waste out if it doesn't work. So, ongoing monitoring. Hello?
There's still a bit of fluctuation, but if you just adjust your mic a bit, I think it will
be better. Yeah, I'll do that. Yeah. Just let me know if it again goes off. I'm holding the mic.
Okay.
So basically, the first step, whether you're for us to manage our waste effectively, segregation at source. As you see, we recommend a three-bin approach at source. Again, biodegradable waste, dry recyclable, and reject waste. We find a lot of people have bins, but they're labeled or color coded. So first step is labeling, color coding, and doing a kind of a waste audit in your plant or in your office. How much waste do you generate a day? What are the different categories? What are the consumables? You start with the waste audit. Then you put a system in place. Recommend biocomposting because we want to recover. We approved cases. I have to change my microphone. Hello, I'm going to change my microphone for some people to hear. Just give me a minute. Is that better now?
Please continue. If there is a problem, I'll let you know.
Yes. Hello? First step is the
question. I'm already speaking. We are not able to listen.
Okay. Is it clear now?
Please go ahead. Please go ahead for 2 minutes. We will see. And we are not able to hear you. Hello.
Hello. Yes, better.
Okay, ma'am. Please continue. Please
Hello?
Continue. We are able to hear you now.
Yeah. Okay. It's an aerobic process. It ensures that you have the temperature, moisture, and you want to balance. If somebody has put a message that they're not able to hear.
Yeah, your voice is frustrating a bit. That's why.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
So basically, air temperature measure is a key element, and therefore your composter should be aerobic. And you need to ensure that along with your biodegradable waste, you have a lot of dry leaves. So a lot of dry leaves that are collected in your compound can also be composted. They're very nutritious and can help you to grow your green cover. So we recommend a whole process where you can get a source. This is just to give you an overview of how it works. Daily, the waste is made. This documentation of weighing and managing is very important for. And the company has about 6 of these M units on their terrace. So this here shows you how they are cascaded and how they've utilized the compost site there on the terrace to grow there. In fact, now in lockdown, they've been sharing pictures of mint, goody, and other things. So people are really motivated now because they are not dependent so much on the outside and they can manage their own garden. This is the terrace garden that they have, and how these can become a resource. It's a very nice example of showing how to become a resource, you know, and increasing the green cover. And then people adopt drip irrigation and get them motivated. Once you start one green, you get motivated to do more green steps. Another aspect from biodegradable is to move to your dry recycling. You can see that there are a 7-bin approach that has been adopted, and you can see we have kept e-waste separate, data pack carton separate, plastic paper, metal. We see about 7 levels of segregation. Another program that we done.
Yes, Manisha.
Yes.
There's a slight disturbance in the background. There's some noise. Okay. Your voice is not clear.
Okay, I'll try and move it a bit. So this is another program that we run where we have our cartons collected. These are milk juice cartons. And with dry waste, it's very important, as in the earlier slides Mr. Sen Gupta shared, he showed from scrapyard to green yard. To make your waste into a resource, very important to value it right in the beginning. So you need to stack it, arrange it, bale it, compact it, whatever is required, so that the transport of the waste to the right recycler is not intense on carbon emissions, and therefore cleaning your waste, drying it, flattening it is one very important step to ensure high levels of recycling. So this is how we have converted these cartons. They get sent to a factory in Palghar, where in the high pressure temperature, pulped and compacted to make sheets. And from the sheets, we can make all kinds of furniture like benches, school desks, even small items like a pen stand. So wealth from waste. When you channelize it for recycling, you ensure that the new product gets used and can substitute wood in this case. So one big application of the composite sheets are in auto rickshaws. If you've been tuk-tuk auto rickshaw, the seat, the back panel, all that is made from recycled composites. So it is one time use, a drink that you have, but if you really value it collected, it can have many good applications on recycling. Just some more pictures to give you an idea of different projects. Like this is a society where they have 50 kgs of wet waste generated daily. The other one on your other side, which is at Baikala, it's about 350 families. So it's in the parking lot. So as long as it's in a ventilated area with a good shade for rain, you keep all sides open, it requires aeration, not too much sun, shady spot, these composters are good. You can keep it even in a sort of in your parking area, but some aeration is recommended for them. It's not on the terrace. Another case study is of a company. This is in Mumbai, close to the airport, Santa Cruz Airport, domestic airport, Vedant Foundation. And they have offices, and they have a canteen in their office. So we have offered them an end-to-end waste management solution where they are converting their biodegradable waste into compost. And they have used 3 of the GreenPro certified RGG systems M model. And in one cycle, cycle for composting takes about 45 days. It's a process. You keep adding your waste on a once the one drum is up and so on. And at 414 kgs of waste in a cycle. So how do we calculate carbon emissions? Because if they were to throw this waste, it would have had to travel all the way to the landfill. So based on truck load, we calculate CO2 emissions. But there are also, if you do a full life cycle assessment, there's a lot of saving that this whole process can help with. So even in a corporate office, we engage the staff. As you see, we do an installation like any other machine. We break a coconut because we want waste management to have its place. To be recognized as an important people-driven activity. And I have, have had over 115 projects across India, and one at Siemens as well, which is a corporate that's adopted the system. And we are amazed to see how the people are so motivated, because the real fruit is the compost, and when they put it in the garden, the flowers, the fruit, really motivate people to segregate their waste at source. So a lot of hand-holding, which is in this process, to kind of get it to be a very natural process. That's what we do. So as you see, we make the process very scientific. It's very important to ensure that the process is odor-free, well-balanced, the pH levels are maintained, it's safe and hygienic. Also, it's pathogen-free. We have done a lot of tests to prove that, because in this model of system of composting, we go up to temperatures 40, 50, 60 degrees in the cooking stage of the cycle. So as you see, I've shown a picture of the cycle. There are different stages. And finally, the pH stabilizes at 7, 8, and your compost is ready. By smell, you can tell, by texture, by color. It's got 40 to 60% moisture. It's very lightweight. Also for gardening, it can help replace soil, because soil, again, causes a lot of land erosion. When people bring soil, they are eroding the land somewhere else and bringing. When you grow your own compost, make your own compost, you can help prevent soil erosion and, protect the area and increase wind cover. Of course, the yield is also only 10%, 10 to 15% as you see. So most of our waste has water. And when we transport it, it's a shame, because we're just transporting our water actually. But if you compact it, use it in your composter, you'll see that only 10%. So for the input you put, you only get 10% output. So most of it is taken care of by evaporation. So we have obviously been endorsed by the municipal corporation. Most of our projects are recognized by them. In some cities, like in Mumbai, the corporation is giving 5% property tax waiver for those who compost at source. So that's a motivation, and we hope more under Swachh Bharat Mission, more corporations across India provide this incentive as a motivation to people to join the programs and adopt systems like this. In schools, we start at a young age, very important, the future in the hands of children. So a lot of schools have adopted this, and kids do it, so they learn young, and it becomes a habit as they grow older. It's some of the work we do at school level. These are our home composters. They're also available on Amazon. That way we are able to reach out to anywhere across India for people to adopt composting. And that's about the impact that we've made over the years with a team, small team in Mumbai. And of course, with the support of organizations like CII and IGBC, RUR has come a long way with about 110 decentralized waste management projects. We have been recycling annually a lot of tons of waste and help mitigate CO2. Thank you so much for having me here, and I'll be happy to take questions as and when as possible. And this is my share on how to make waste into wealth. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Manisha, for sharing this valuable presentation with us. This also can be looked at as a community engagement activity.
That's right.
And also, the activity that is doing at the practice that inculcates later on when they grow up. So, this is one good thing that we could learn today from your presentation. There are a few questions, ma'am, that are sent to you. You can just answer them, please do. Or else we can take the questions at the end of the session as well. You can address the questions for the benefit of the whole audience.
Yes, it would work. I can wait till the end and get you as suitable to you.
Yes. Now I would like to invite Mr. Balaji Saravanan.
Yes. Yes.
Sir, I made you a presenter. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Yes, sir, I made you a presenter. You can share your screen now. Hello.
Yes. Yeah, good afternoon.
The screen is visible. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon. Good afternoon, CIA. Good afternoon to all the participants. I am Ms. Balaji. I am working in the Visakha industry as a textile professional. Yes, I would like to share value chain of recycled to polyester yarn process. Within our group, the Visakha Industries Limited, we are having the vision and mission on making sustainable products with Green Pro concept. We are making fiber cement roof and V-panel, V-board for drywall and V-plank and atom integrated atom roof, then wonder yarn, the textile. So I want to, before going to the recycled polyester, I would like to share what is the polyester. The polyester process during the early stages of fundamental research of DuPont in 1941, the polyester was developed. The polyester is the product of the reaction between diethylic alcohol and dicarbonic acid. It is almost a petrochemical product. There is a homemade from crude oil, then refining and distribution, then naphtha, then paraxylene, then cracker, ethylene, ethylene oxidation. Then after the purified terephthalic acid and MEG, methyl ethyl glycol, adding the polyester will come. The polyester is diverted into polyester oriented yarn, that is another segment. Another is polyester staple fiber for spun yarn. Finally, it comes to the fabric. In middle, one is a PET. This is a PET bottle. So PET bottle used for domestic use, for water, water container. This is the polyester process chain. PTA plant, cellulose, then slurry preparation, reactor, then spinning. Now we come to the subject PET. This is a PET bottle. Amit, you are hearing? Hello?
Yes, sir, we are able to hear you. Please go ahead.
It's a PET bottle. The PET bottle after consumption, just we are throwing it anywhere. This is a high challenge for environmental. This is a huge of PET bottle on the floor. It is a high conversion. This is a very big threat for landfilling. Then sea. The trillions of bottles in the sea. Then what did you do from this garbage PET bottle? That's why this is the process that's developed by polyester manufacturers. So many manufacturers are there in the polyester. Then used to bottle, this bottle baling, the bottle is thought out, the plastic portion is removed, then the PET portion is sorted out. That is a shredded and cutting into the small flake. The flakes again melted. The melted flakes again made into the polyester fiber. This is the fiber. This is the cycle. Here the fiber. From the fiber, the yarn to be manufactured at the spinning industries. The yarn is going to the fabric for knitted and woven industries. What is the advantage of this recycled polyester fiber?
Yeah,
the lowest carbon footprint compared to other fibers of the shell. The fibers are available in raw white. Pre-colored fibers are also available. There's no need of dyeing. Then carbon footprint comparison. This is some of the green gold. This is one of the manufacturer. It's making a premium quality. The name of green gold. But compared to cotton, it's a lower carbon footprint. One more advantage is negligible water requirement against the massive water requirement for cotton. Drastically reduces the toxicity caused by pesticides and fertilizers required by the natural fiber. These are the advantages. On replacing 33% of cotton in one pair of jeans. Hello? Background green. Yeah, clear? Why is it clear?
Right now it's clear, sir. Please go ahead.
Okay. Background green gold. This is charge. The 24% of greenhouse gas emission reduced. 3,218 liters of water saved. For making one jean, 15 bottles rescued from landfilling. The 15 bottles you can make one jean. 33% decrease in pesticides plus lesser energy and materials for dyeing. This is another chart on replacing 52% of cotton in one t-shirt. This is the Recron recycled green gold polyester fiber. 88% of greenhouse gas emission reduced. 1,414 liters of water saved. 12 bottles rescued from landfill. 52% decrease in pesticide. These are the recycled fiber end users. This polyester can be used as 100% and blending with cotton or some other viscose fiber, some other fibers for making variety of fabric, including home textiles, curtains, bed sheets, furnishings, technical textiles, then fashion wear, men's and women's apparel. These are some of the products. then how it can be manufactured? It is not easy to manufacture with anybody. It should have some standards of certification. From the fiber manufacturer, I have to get the certification with the global recycled standard. Some certification bodies are worldwide. They are issuing the certificate. It is having some guidelines and norms to process the recycled polyester. It is having supply chain also. This is a pre-consumer polyester, but what we are saying is a post-consumer polyester. There are 2-3 standards are there. One is GRS, Global Recycled Standard requirement. It needs supply chain requirement. The supply chain requirement, the traceability. You have to get the product, certified product. That product has to be processed separately without contaminating to the other process. You have to maintain all the separate channels and traceabilities. It should be monitored by the certification body. Every year they are coming for audit and verifying the record. Each and every transaction from the raw material supplier up to the consumer end, it should be issued by some transaction certificate for the particular quantity. Suppose you are buying the raw material with one bill or invoice, some quantity, that should be taken to the spinners. They are show that how much they are consumed under a particular invoice. That should be submitted to the certification body. The certification body should check all the records. Then they can issue one transaction certificate. This much quantity has produced from this particular. For further transactions, we have to mention all the transaction certificate numbers. Then the global recycled standard requirements. There are 4 categories of mandatory requirements. One is supply chain, then is social requirement. The social requirement includes labor and wages and health. What are the measures we are taking against their health? Including minimum wages. All these requirements we have to fulfill. Then environmental requirements. So we have to get the environmental management system certification, or we should have some our own standards of environmental procedure. Then chemical requirements. The hazardous chemicals not allowed. They are having list of restricted chemicals. This is the global recycle standard. Is having some large organizations. They are having proper setup. They are having establishments for HR and all the departments. Some small organizations. That one more thing. The GRS, global minimum 20% recycled content should be there. Below 20% recycling, they cannot issue the GRS certification. Then another one more option they are giving is the RCS, recycled claim standard requirement. This is required only supply chain requirement. No need of any social, environmental, and chemical. This can be able to use up to minimum 5% recycled content. They are issuing the certificate. This is the flow of documents in the transaction certificate system. Raw material verification is also a certificate holder. Then they are using transaction certificate. Then it comes to spinning. They also get this license or certification. Then transaction certificate. Then go to the next end, knitting or weaving. These are get the transaction certificate. Then dyeing. Until go to the brand and retailer, the supply chain should be maintained. So many countries nowadays they are insisting to produce the recycled content product. Now, all that, including uniforms, then other menswear and womenswear and upholstery segments, the recycled content is increasing day by day. This is the PET bottle process. From PET bottle, we're making a value added polyester yarn and fabric. Okay, thank you, Mr. Hanan.
Thank you very much, sir, for the wonderful presentation and also what are the process involved in getting these certifications and all, and what are the guidelines you have to follow. I would request the attendees to ask your questions if there are any for the panelists to answer. So there is one question for Ms. Manisha.
Yes, hi.
Yes, ma'am. So what is the percentage of compost you get from total biodegradable waste in the RUR compost? What is the space requirement?
Yeah, so basically the compost cycle is 45 days, and at the end of that period you get 10% yield. So it depends on the input. For example, if you have say 50 kgs of biodegradable waste daily, then you would need our six of our L-size tumblers, and each takes about 25 square feet of space, right? So in about 150 square feet of space, you can handle 50 kgs of biodegradable waste. So if you have less, you need less space. If you have more, you need more. And you keep, it's a continuous cycle. You keep adding your waste, and then over a period, when it's filled up, we start the next one, and you get 10% yield. So if you're daily adding 50 kgs, then in a month, it would be 1500. In 6 weeks, you get 150 kgs of compost, or which you can directly apply to your garden. I hope I've answered the question.
So next question is from Balaji. So yes. They are asking regarding the precast housing material that being done. So
pardon?
They are asking if Vishaka is into precast housing material. So I think they are asking about the Vishaka boards and the products related to that.
Vishaka products.
Sir, the exact question is, are you in precast housing material in waste?
No, why is it studying, sir?
Hello?
Tell me.
Sir, it is regarding a precast housing material by Vishaka. There is a query about that.
Your voice is not getting. Hello?
Hello? Yes, sir, are you able to hear me?
Yeah. Tell me.
So they are asking about the precast housing material by Vishaka.
Precast housing, yeah. There is a given the website, so I will show you. Please visit this vishaka.in. My board division will answer. Otherwise, share my our number. We will guide them. Okay.
Okay. So, this regarding this Vishaka inquiries, you can also share this inquiry directly.
Yeah. I'll give my number and our Himanshu's number. Huh?
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Maybe details of the speakers also will be shared as a thank you mail. Thank you for the recording thing of this webinar, along with the contact details of our speakers will be shared. So if you have any queries later on also, you may get in touch with them on this in this regard. So if there are any more questions, request the attendees to post them so that we can take them up now. Otherwise, we will be closing the session in the next 5 minutes. So there is a question for Manisha.
Yes. Yeah.
So what would be the cost of compost machine for house of 10 members in family?
Yeah. So if we have 10 in like one family, I guess 10 members would generate about 2 to 3 kilograms of waste per day. Ideally, 4 members generate about 700 grams per kg. So I'm just multiplying that. We can of course do an evaluation to see how much waste that would be the best. But assuming it's 3 kgs, then we have our S model composter, and that would come up to a ballpark of 40,000 rupees one-time capex, and then ongoing there is no cost for that managing the waste. So one-time capital cost. And they can write to us, and we will work out a suitable solution for your requirements.
Okay. Next question is regarding the smell issue. Is there a smell issue during the process, and all is the question? This is for Ms. Nisha.
Yes. So composting as a process is managed well, then like everyone's been to a forest, right? In forest composting happens naturally. Leaves fall, trees fall, everything falls, and we never get any smell when we go in a forest because it's aerobic and nature is taking care of the process. So as such, because of the natural process, it should not generate odor. The odor comes when it becomes anaerobic. So your waste has nitrogen, your leaves has carbon. If there's enough oxygen, then the process gives you CO2. But if you don't put oxygen, then you get NH3 and CH4, which is methane and ammonia, which causes smell. So the idea that you find a system which has a good aerobic management in it, air is going in, and you balance your pile well, because a lot of moisture gets released with our wet waste, we have to add dry leaves. So once you balance, you rotate your tumbler well, you ensure it's an aerobic pile, then no smell will happen. So it's possible to do it odor-free, and we have been running over 120 projects now successfully on a sustainable composting regularly. It works well.
Okay. So there's a query from Mr. Raju John. So he's asking, put some light on biogas plant. So if any speaker is interested, they can take a suggestion.
I can help with the biogas option. Yes, biogas is an alternative for converting biodegradable waste into gas. It makes sense when you have an application for the gas. That means you have a canteen or a setup where you will get a lot of cooked food waste, and then you have enough space and enough requirements to utilize the gas. So if it's in your residential society, a place like that, or in a small school, or even in an office where you're not really cooking and all, that makes sense because the application is less for the gas, and therefore compost is a good opportunity because you can grow your garden with it. So there are biogas technologies, again, small for household all the way up to larger projects like 1,000 kgs a day. So when you go like really big numbers, 1,000, 2,000 kgs of waste coming out, then biogas is a viable option, and it's worth the investment to put it in.
Okay, ma'am. Next question is also for you. So yes. The other question is, can you please show sites where your projects are working? And also, what is the total area required for complete setup for managing 250 kg per day organic waste?
250 kgs, is it? Sorry, so you can just repeat, what was the question again? I didn't hear the first
one. Part is, can you please show sites where your projects are working? I think your website, they have a...
Yes. Website has, I showed some examples here. That was the Baikala one that I showed you with many composters in the basement area. That has 350 families at Planet Godrej building. And they have 18 tumblers cascaded connected. Yes, our website has all the permutations, and you can write to us on info@rui.co.in, and we will send you special details with regard to your quantity of waste and area. And for 250 kgs of input waste, we can work it out for you and tell you space requirement. Like if you email us, we will send a detail. There's an option beyond 200 kg to go for an electrical system. So we can discuss that. So if you use a shredder in combination with a composter, about 200-250 kg, the space can be worked out. So based on your requirement, we can customize a solution for you.
Yeah. And there's a question, is it possible to visit a waste management project in society in Mumbai?
Yeah, surely. We have in Mumbai, our office is based in Mahim in Mumbai, and we can definitely escort you and take you and give you a tour of project sites there in Mumbai. Many we have in all across the city, so wherever you are located closest to you. And if you're outside of Mumbai, then we can also look at the cities like we are in Chennai, in Vijayawada, Calcutta, so Delhi. So based on where you are located, we would be happy to give you a tour of biocomposting station facility.
So there's a question from Antiraj. Is it required any training to maintain compost, and how many days does it take to get one harvest?
Yes. Yeah.
Correct.
We have in Vijayawada three projects, which is close to Hyderabad. So we can we usually do the first installation where we come, and then we do remote training via videos and phone, especially now with this situation, I'm sure a lot of it is going to go online. So a lot of our projects work with remote management. It's a simple process. Of course, it takes one cycle to learn balance. It's not like you start today and you'll get it tomorrow. But through the first 6 weeks, we will train you well for you to be independent after that. So it's usually training and handholding in the first cycle, which takes 6 weeks. After that, most sites become independent and they manage with one or two people from their staff, housekeeping staff. And we do it in all languages also, so we can train in local language and we can work out training to suit the language requirements as well.
Okay, thank you. So there are no further questions, but yes, the recording of this session, as right. well as the contact details of the presenters, they will be shared with all the registrants by tomorrow or the day after in a follow-up thank you mail. So I would like to thank all the speakers, Mr. Sabyasachi, Ms. Manisha, and Mr. Badaji, for sharing the valuable insights with us. As all the attendees could see, so we expanded upon the various waste-to-wealth concepts. Many industrial-related aspects were shared by Mr. Sabyasachi. At a community level, the engagement could be seen in Ms. Manisha's presentation, as well as how various different daily use products and garments they can be replaced with recycled plastic. That was seen from Mr. Balaji's presentation. So with this, I hope the attendees were able to gain some valuable insights into how they can convert their virgin use materials into some of the recycled based materials, and also reduce their carbon footprint overall. So with this, we come to an end this session. Any further queries, they can be addressed to the speakers when their contact details are shared, or if you you can write to us also, we will forward the same to the relevant speaker so that they can get back to you. Hope this was a valuable session to all the attendees, and they were able to gain some knowledge and some inspiration from this session. So with this, we come to an end. Once again, I thank all the attendees for taking out your valuable time and attending this session, and all the speakers for presenting with their valuable insights and immense knowledge. So with this, we come to an end. So closing the session now.
Thank you so much, and thank you to all the speakers and the attendees.
Thank you all.
Take care, stay safe.
Thank you to all the speakers. Thank you, Manisha. Thank you, Mr. Balaji. Okay. Thank you.
Bye.
Hemant.
Yes, thank you. Thank you all.
Well, yeah, bye.